Okay, so for our next speaker, we are very pleased, very honored again to welcome Professor Babit Babich from Fordham University in New York City, my former hometown. Her research emphasizes the philosophy of science and technology from a continental perspective, for those of you who know that distinction, in addition to ancient philosophy and philosophical aesthetics, especially sculpture and music. Recent books that Professor Babich has published include Günther Anders' Philosophy of Technology in 2022, Nietzsche's Plastik 2021, Nietzsche's Antike in 2020, The Hallelujah Effect, published in 2013 and issued again in 2016, Words in Blood Like Flowers in 2006. In addition to editing the journal New Nietzsche Studies, her edited collections include Reading David Hume's Of the Standard of Taste, Classic Philosophy, 2019, and Hermeneutic Philosophies of Social Science, published in 2017, as well as editing Patrick Aidan Heelan's posthumous text called The Observable, Heisenberg's Philosophy of Quantum Mechanics. So it is without further ado that we are pleased to have Professor Babich. Please, thank you.
Thank you so much. I'm gonna try to see if I can share a screen just so that you can have that. I think that's it, but who knows. Do you see a bigger version of the could you do? Okay. Now, there's always problems with computers. They like to make their presence known. I have a couple of sections. I want to begin by thanking Mike Sifone, along with this morning speakers, and I really mean that. I mean that with all my heart. I'm very grateful. I should say at the outset, just to begin with, that I'm sympathetic to Limina's overall project. Nevertheless, even though I am, that's what continental philosophy means, I am as open-minded a philosopher of science as they come, I have to say that philosophy of science, of UAPs, unidentified aerospace phenomena, is no more likely than a philosophy of acupuncture as a science. This does not mean that acupuncture is not, it is, a well-theorized science. It works, thoroughly attested over thousands of years. Likewise, Ayurvedic medicine is a science. And there's also a science of homeopathy, the last limited to just a few centuries. It's not as old as Ayurveda or acupuncture, but still clocking in at longer standing than viruses, which have prevailed as a paradigm for less than a century and a good deal of scientific disputation. Some scientists are not sure, I started in biology, that viruses exist when my be dealing with artifacts, cellular debris, and so on. But Western science loves viruses, where it does not recognize acupuncture or Ayurvedic medicine, and certainly not, it really hates homeopathy. The only medical science that counts as such is Western medical science. There's no alternative medicine. That's bogus, despite books and websites to the contrary. Not if it's science you want. There's also medical anthropology, but even in the latter case, even where one might explore non-Western medical paradigms, the standard remains Western scholarship, and it's always Western ethnography or the whites. As Bruno Latour famously put it in his We Have Never Been Modern, or on the modern cult of the factitious gods, which thus explore or explain other cultures' exotic medical practices. For another example, It's the coordination with theory and a consistent scheme of explanation, as well as government funding, you always need money, that makes astronomy a science in the absence of samples. We actually have no star stuff anywhere on Earth, or any other direct experimental data on the sun or any other star. This is opposed to astrology, which also has observations and records going back in various astrological systems, as there are several of these. Think the Chaldeans and the Greeks, as well as the Egyptians and the Chinese for thousands of years. Thus, the famous rhetorical tactic, this is rhetoric, that Paul Feyerabend used to annoy his colleagues, durable to this day, involved posting his own horoscope. That was actually his own horoscope as frontispiece to the updated 1981, it was a little red volume, Suhrkamp edition of Erkenntnis für freie Menschen. How, just to cite the question he poses here, it's in German, how is a citizen, so Feyerabend totally agrees with Professor Moriti here, how is a citizen to judge the prescriptions of the institutions that surround him, that live off his money and organize his existence, and how judge these institutions themselves? Another context. Sorry, I had a whole head that spelled out. I should have given you that before, sorry. Easier to read. I like to joke, about Pluto's planetary status as it waxes and wanes. And my philosophical friend Chris Bateman has recently mused on his blog that the only scientific reason for demoting Pluto from planet to dwarf planet or wanderer, both names, planet wanders the same, as a planet simply wanders, a depiction pointing to the moving stars, that's a planet, as opposed to the fixed stars, that's the Empyrean, is convention, whereby, and not for reasons of any new dirt on Pluto, we don't have any new data on Pluto, that caused its fall from planetary grace, but simply a collective decree or decision. Science, in addition to all that, is a growth industry. As John Zeman, I met him before he died, explains, the size of science has doubled steadily every 15 years. In a century, this means a factor of 100 for every single scientific paper or for every single scientist. In 1670, there were 100 in 1770, 10,000 in 1870, and a million in 1970. So too, Derek de Solla Price and his Little Science, Big Science. And over the last 3 years of COVID science, we have gone full totalitarian, speaking of the science. It's like Trump, the Donald, the science. Now, I've written about these tactics and the co-option of our goodwill, as I have a paper on this, inventing epidemics, and in fact, the police state and everything involved with inventing a pandemic. Nevertheless, despite my critical perspective, I remain enough of an idealist about science to regard this as a co-option of science, though there's considerable evidence, and this is the topic of Feyerabend's most famous book, Against Method, that science has been this way since antiquity. I should also say that Feyerabend, just to say it again, would agree, especially his work after Against Method, with the reference and the importance of bringing citizens into the discussion, or, as we've just heard from Professor Mariti. Now, Against Method is less a book, contra method, most people just read the title and they end there, than it is a surprisingly sustained expose against Galileo, against his character flaws, his corruption, and his lies, his illusionary claims. He said he saw, he didn't see. It's not the church who didn't see, according to Feyerabend. It's Galileo who couldn't possibly have seen what he said he saw. Now, most philosophy of science doesn't touch the topic of science and of money, or science and control or collusion, despite the names I just mentioned, Zeman, and who's a sociologist, historian of science, and de Solla Price. And Feyerabend's colleagues in philosophy of science denounced him unrelentingly, calling him science's worst enemy in his lifetime, making Feyerabend, that was the era, after all, of Bertolt Brecht, the anti-Galileo. After his death, they simply wrote fire Robbins out of the curriculum by avoiding mention of him or his work. So mentioning mentioning UFOs would be a great achievement, but we don't even talk about fire Robbins in Hong Kong. Which silent treatment is the way both science and philosophy of science make their most persuasive arguments. The same fate would be suffered by Bruno Latour, who died this past summer, for the crime of having co-written Laboratory Live about the foibles and complications of the Salk Institute. Actually, his crime had more to do with coming from a Catholic Hawaiian family and being educated in hermeneutics, that's also continental philosophy. And in medicine, Ludwig Fleck, there is the French translation of Fleck's originally German book, who wrote brilliantly about the Entstehung, the genesis and development of a scientific fact, that's the Wasson test for syphilis, while confounding his readers by pointing out just how difficult a disease syphilis happens to be when it comes to getting tertiary symptoms. No matter how many observations of UAPs, no matter how thoroughly and respectably unexplained they may be, they cannot constitute the subject matter for a science unless a collection of individuals recognized as scientists decides on the reasons they are unexplained and proceeds then to explain them. One man did do that in the case of UAPs and wrote several books. He didn't just write one, but one man or two or 20 does not a science make. There still be no philosophy of science of unexplained aerospace phenomena, quite by definition. Explainable phenomena are subject matter for science. Unexplained phenomena are damned. Philosophy of science on the proposition, if the moon is made of a green cheese, what follows? One of my teachers was fond of explaining logical entailment and how it worked in philosophy of science. That was Patrick Aidan Heelan. He was a Jesuit and he was a physicist. And his name will tell you how Irish he was. If the moon's made of a green cheese, he would say, then I am a Dutchman. We students were perplexed. Obviously, that's what students usually are. An Irish professor, a Patrick, no less. The green made sense to us because we were American. Think St. Patrick's Day. But he was only half Irish. His mother was Belgian. That's Flemish or quasi-Dutch. Things got worse. Logically, as one is entitled, this is the point of logic, to derive anything one likes, or in other words, anything follows. Fire Robbins' term, anything goes. If one begins with a false claim or contradiction, ex falso, sequitur, quod libet, ex contradictione, I missed the E there, quod libet. Now, this is dynamite, and modern logicians speak of explosion when it comes to axiomatic systems, formally speaking, eliminating just by beginning with the contradiction, both truth and falsity, which leaves us with the quod libet we began with, and which modern logicians condemn as trivial. To rescue which, such that logic might proceed, they invent what they call, which is how the problem is solved, paraconsistency. Now, at issue is not the fact of, or the truth of, or falsity of the claim, as factic or ontic detail has no relevance in logic, as what matters in logic, always, is consistency. Logic being the conservative art of ensuring that one keeps or saves the truth one begins with. Science of a physical kind will also be a matter, to use the same term as we do in philosophy of science, of saving the phenomena. But that's a little more troublesome. Hence, Patrick, another Patrick, Varden, do I have that? Yes, here. In his rational approach to the UFO problem, in another path, we have three paths right now, collective volume, philosophy of science, and the occult, talks of Epsilon Eridani, a planet he specifies as located in some relatively close solar system. An analytically minded philosopher, as most philosophers are, Warden wants to make it easy for aliens to visit us. He's very generous in his thought experiment, and thus he emphasizes proximity, as he also assumes, for reasons that escape me, that technology takes no leaps, as it were, but just gets better along the same continuum we already know, and likewise that aliens, if they are coming to us, would have to travel to us as we would have to travel to them. Ergo size matters. That is, the size of the parsecs to be traversed, as distances matter when it comes to the vastness of the universe. The problem is that even this is implausible, barring a trip maybe to Mars, going there and come back, given the current capacities of space travel, such as they are, or such as they are not, one might be limited to Saturn or Pluto or the other outer planets, dwarf or otherwise. A trip to another solar system is fairly out of the question until we get some kind of warp drive. Thank you, Star Trek. For my part, I'm inclined to assume that if aliens are doing space travel, what they would not be doing is traveling to us using technology, aerodynamic principles, indeed the very reference to air and its elasticity as to issues of a layered atmosphere, emanations surrounding a star or a planet, are local assumptions, assuming the view not from nowhere, but exactly from this Earth. I like the comment about Abbott's Flatland in the chat, that was great, which is where we are, and arguably ceteris paribus, all things being equal, accordingly. So if we want a robust example of a UAP, that'd be this diagram here, we'll want a decent saucer shape, maybe fairly petite in size, matching the proportions of the touted lunar landing craft, or else Hindenburg-like, we're going to want a cylindrical conveyance, or neatly futuristic and excellently Nazi-style, to boot, a flying wedge or triangle. Notice again the influence of aerodynamic streamlining, because this is how we think. Never mind about space and its vacuums, or what have you. By contrast with morphological classifications, my thought experiment concerns beings we might not see, UAPs of an invisible kind, which means that they would not as such be phenomena. Post-COVID, we're used to the notion of being sick without symptoms, hence perhaps I might stipulate invisible, asymptomatic UAPs beyond the limits of sense perception, as one might not rule out PCR-style tests to detect these, and this might work. Until someone showed that the results, like the results of the PCR tests, was perhaps spurious. So I have sympathy, of course, very much indeed for Jeff's paper and his claim. It's not too far-fetched, because it's measurable on the electromagnetic spectrum that we happen to live surrounded by all matters of electromagnetic radiations, and it's proper to speak of EMFs and so on. An oncological theorist studying the history and etiology of cancer surmised that today's rates of cancer are directly correlated to the ambient radiation we ignore, simply and very much because we cannot see it. I suppose, and here I share Professor De La Torre's perspective on Gibsonian affordance of a constitutive kind, that aliens have not only already visited us, brought here in whatever shape of ship or conveyance they may have used, and even perhaps that they have taken up residence among us. Note that I am precisely not presupposing lizard people on the model of the film Invasion of the Body Snatchers. Much rather, life might be possible along a fair continuum, speaking of elemental states of matter, solid, liquid, gas, plasma, or aether, which is my preferred word, and not merely a matter of the so-called carbon-based, as sci-fi authors like to say, solid matrix states. My thought experiment, and here again, I echo Professor Kripa's reference to blue orbs. My reference supposes more generically that there might be creatures of aether or Kripal, Jeff, calls plasma, vibrating in different frequencies, light blue or otherwise, or some other spectrum apart from ourselves. If they could, and that would be what I'm assuming, if they would move, they would then move or vibrate or resonate in and among us without our awareness, just as wavelengths of all kinds already do, just as we expose ourselves whenever we use our cell phones, walk down the street under 5G equipped street lights, we don't even notice them, or when we fly, both when we pass through security and when aloft, quite exposed to radiation we do not perceive, but which is very aerospace and quite explained. If we can't see them, and we would not see them, perhaps they would also move through space-time differently. Can one claim that they exist? Now I need Professor Kripal's expertise. This is a long-standing question in philosophy, as this is also the subject matter of theology, and not less parapsychology. Philosophy of science and UAPs is a subset of occult phenomena. By definition, UAPs are phenomena. But patent as they are when it comes to seeing them and photographing and otherwise recording them and making reports about them has been done for decades and centuries and so on, phenomena have weak ontological credentials when it comes to philosophy and not less when it comes to science. Thus, if one can show an image of a flying pig, for a homey American example, the news will not change zoological classification, even if we have a genetically mRNA type pig, nota bene, not a human pig hybrid of the kind that we already have in production so that we might harvest kidneys and hearts for medical transplantation to go along with our bacon, but tweaked out with wings. Now, this might make the National Enquirer, which is also the secret hint in the pop and equally hokey film series Men in Black. For many investigators, the theme is pre-populated by residues of old philosophical terminology, belief, justified true belief, and to this extent, one may regard UFOs, UAPs, as a matter of belief. And this takes us back to the Platonic distinction between appearance or phenomena and ideal or true being. Plato tells us that the ideal is the real, everything else, everything merely empirical, things that seem to be real or factual or merely observable, is contingent. A good student of Parmenides, Plato held that because empirical matters are subject to change or alteration, this makes them ultimately unknowable and uncertain at best qua objects of belief. This conviction infuses mathematics and logic to this day. It also confuses many people, as it's popular to assume that empirical proof would be all that's needed. To the extent that one can assume that the great achievement of last summer's release of formally classified documents on UAPs might be regarded as a step in the direction of proving UAPs, almost as if the next step could be guided tours through Roswell, perhaps with Meet the Alien tickets on auction for premium subscribers, or maybe just for William Shatner. This is the argument from authority. And all that matters here is and will be getting the right authority. It's also a fallacy. For my part and to my mind, this isn't faith per se, but fairly justified belief. There are UAPs because such have been reported and observed over millennia. Such reports are transmitted to us. History attests to at least this. I also wonder if the initial or first reports from Roswell, for example, were not accurate. Additionally, it's not improbable that the subsequent debunking of the reports of reducing the phenomena to something explicable, let it be ye old weather balloon, are transparent instances of damage control or government manipulation, not too different if with a more meager operating budget than the Warren Commission, the 9/11 Commission, or the retrospective admission that there were actually no weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, contra Bush's assertions to the contrary, and which admission had zero consequences for anyone or anything. In addition, it strains credulity to suppose that there's any scenario in which government agencies would care to provide full information on anything related to UAPs other than whitewash. That's not a conspiracy theory. What's important, as I follow Nietzsche here, is that to assume that one knows such things to be true is as unfounded as to assume that one knows such things to be untrue. From an epistemological point of view, both assumptions presume too much. The craft that crashed in Roswell 7 July 1947 was initially reported by the Roswell Army Airfield as a craft, which in military parlance they called a disc. So there was a conveyance, and then, this is the most notorious of the Roswell claims, there were the bodies, also said to have been found and immediately whisked away. The official story found it necessary, however it may have struck them as observers themselves, to write an official report subsequently attributing the first responders' report to a misguided assessment of a fully explicable and thus explained phenomenon, a weather balloon, sufficiently alien, meaning rare enough to be mistaken for a crash saucer. It's actually, if you look at these fragments, they're supposed to have been gathered from the countryside. They're extraordinarily neat. You can almost see the absolutely perfect science fair balsa wood. Amazing. Anyway, at random. Decades later, in 1994, this would be revised retrospectively as a nuclear test surveillance balloon. Never mind Roswell. as it's inflammatory, how are we going to get a science of UAPs, Roswell included, so that we can have a philosophy of science, of the science of UAPs? Can one simply collate all the data, arrange it systematically and frame hypotheses to explain the data? Would that yield a science? Is that enough? Now, oddly, we've got that, the data, along with more than a few hypotheses. Charles Fort already mentioned, the Bronx historian and archivist wrote the Book of the Damned, already dedicated to this. And of course, the same problem as what I already mentioned, what's received and what's excluded or damned, is a huge issue in science and correspondingly in philosophy of science. That's the original front page of the Book of the Damned. So Tom Kuhn uses the term normal, and as that has been standardized ever since, to mention him and to mention Kuhn's case for revolution in science is necessary because to bring UAPs into the canon of philosophy, whether epistemology or philosophy of science, ontology being far too general, requires revolution to the extent that the received view excludes, by definition, mention of UAPs. So you can only have hyperbole, counterfactual, or green cheese, and so on and so forth. I've already mentioned Pat Grimm's philosophy of science and the occult. The issue could be the problem of demarcation, not as Larry Loudon articulated the problem, but high school debating team style, loaded in advance to differentiate science from pseudoscience. So the book leads with objections to astrology, a statement by 186 scientists, because obviously 186, that's also the argument from popularity, and that's also a fallacy, can't be wrong, followed by Fire Robin's ironic, the irony tends to be lost on some readers, the strange case of astrology. And that was the end of the story. So nothing proceeded from there. So inventing pseudoscience, where are we? I already mentioned in the German version, 1935, the genesis and development of a scientific fact. And I've already gone through some discussion of the difficulty. What we're interested in is separating the wheat from the chaff. A judgmental affair meant to come in with the probity of angels, to speak almost in Fire Robin's language, as we might be reminded that William Blake saw angels in the trees. But as Fire Robin's critics cite Blake, as an indictment, I come, Blake says, to cast off Bacon, Locke, and Newton. Sight of a star in the east might also fall under the rubric of UAPs, but it also animates the distinction between science and pseudoscience, supposed true and supposed fake news. It's also how a reading public can be urged to dismiss the work of Latour and Steve Woolgar, who wrote Laboratory Science and used to foment constructivist anxieties. And that was the passage that I just met. So one thing to pay attention to is that Latour recanted. Of course he did, right? He's not Bruno. He recanted. He wrote Pandora's Hope, but so did Hacking. He recanted the structure, a social construction of what, after a very radical approach. There's a whole bunch of problems right there. Now, I went over this slide too fast, but I wanted to make sure that I catch it, just because philosophers, not many philosophers of science, but philosophers have written straightforwardly and not just making fun of UAPs, like Professor Michael Zimmerman and others at the very prestigious rights, because in 1952, there's an article we have from Benjamin Apthorpe Gould Fuller, Flying Saucers. And I want to acknowledge Dr. Mike Siphone, who reminded me. I had read it before, but I thought it was weird. But I think it's really necessary to look at that one more time. But what's significant, of course, is that we don't remember his name. He's just not remembered. He, too, has been forgotten. So where are we? What's the state of the art? In a philosophy lecture, especially one having to do with science, a popular convention argues the case for progress. Isn't nature wonderful? Isn't science grand? Aren't we all enlightened? But with respect to UAPs, the best we can do, as I've tried to suggest, is add the argument from authority, the National Security Agency, which doesn't really mind and will give us A to Z, what is actually pretty uninformative list of supposed full information. Now, one responds, this is crucial, to any untoward evidence by ignoring it. We do that's also denial, that's our technique, and it's also what we do in science, and it's also what we do in philosophy. And what's important about that is that it works utterly and completely. So all you have to do is not mention a colleague. It's ghosting. It also works when you're dating. So how could it not work in all those other fields? It's my last section, Saving the Phenomena and Politics of Scientific Theory and Scientific Practice. Just turn to that.
Just so you know, Professor Babbage, 2:30 was the end point. So if we're perhaps wrapping it up at this point, I
that's exactly what I'm doing with my last section. So at issue is not what's seen, but challenging the credibility of the report, and thereby insisting that the credulity of the reporter, and maybe those who believe the reporter, is the problem. As one believes in ghosts or past lives or astrology, one might believe in flying saucers or alien visitations or unidentified aerospace phenomena. The identification, not the unidentified, is what must be stressed. Just as chemtrails are dismissed, denied, even as these are arguably one of the most prevalent or abundant instances of UAPs, they're not identified, which means that one is free to suppose they're not an issue. And so goes the slippery slope, maybe not a phenomenon at all. To this extent, authority, fallacious as an argument as it is the rule. The famous Roswell incident was reported as an event with quite a bit of detail and a certain amount of complexity when you looked at the first account. And then, of course, brushed away to something else. Once again, terribly neat fragments gathered and put in the back of a pickup truck. Amazing. It's astonishing. They look almost as if someone had just neatly torn them, but never. If you look at that neatly torn, to me, everything ends there. What is at issue is the status of the scientific object, the referent, whether you can count it among Eddington-style world furniture or the Searlian things themselves. At issue is the phenomena. That's the thing we think we're looking for. And I wanted to, just the reason why I was wanting to make sure I got to my ending, was because I wanted to end by referring to the first talk today. Greg Egidians, who talks about SETI looking at what counts as science and what counts as pseudoscience and where one thinks one can be going. I have that different reference, but I'm not so sure we could see them, even if we could see them. And the question of the evolution of technology, which is another issue which I have another section for, which some people say that we actually did get quite a bit from those fallen spacecraft. And that explains why iPhones today are not particularly good, because there's no new tech to be able to rip off. That leaves one with Fermi's paradox. If you've got all of these aliens, where are they? You don't have a problem, because, of course, if you assume that they are as we are, then you would expect to see them. If we're not the last end, the be-all and the end-all, it's not a problem or a paradox at all. Sorry, Enrico. The other tiny point is that we're doing this on the internet. One of the most important things to emphasize, and that's why Feyerabend could read about Galileo, is that he was able to look, and Ludwig Fleck was able to look, at actual books. Today we have everything online, and because we have everything online, everything is completely hackable, and all by itself, even if you don't hack it, you have the bit rot, or the data rot, or data creep or drift, which means that the data disintegrate themselves all by themselves. Books can last centuries. Data, rather less distinctly than a century. Philosophy of science won't make room for UAPs. It has enough problems with chemistry. We don't even have a philosophy of chemistry at this point. And also alchemy, which makes it hard in turn to understand not only Isaac Newton, but also John Locke. My choice of examples, and I'm happy to echo Africa here, very, very important, but also South America, is to emphasize that this is an object for a tourist industry, unfortunately, not science and not philosophy of science. To be an object for science, it'd have to be investigated. That would require secrecy. We're back to conspiracy theory in order to prevent all kinds of other issues, not to speak of whatever might be at stake in the sentence that follows the first word of greeting or the call for help from an extraterrestrial. We're not ourselves particularly good. We are ourselves the problem. We would do to them what the European invaders did to the autochthonous peoples of Meso and South America and Africa and the Indias and everywhere else in the world. They killed them. all or most of them, and took their stuff. We are astonishingly violent beings by nature. We like what we know and tend to hate what we don't. For this and other reasons, we're not good with those who are all too terrestrial aliens. The only counter to our ineluctably destructive violence would be if the space aliens turned out to be superior to us, that is, more powerful than we are. Which also leaves us back with lizards. Thanks for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Professor Babbage.
Stop that chair. I'm going to make that chair, stop. How do I stop? There it goes. Boom.
Thank you. Quite a lot to think about. I'm going to turn this over to our discussant, from whom we will be hearing towards the end of our symposium, Professor Daniel Coombe of the Niels Bohr Institute. I'll turn it over to you for some comments, and then we can take questions from the audience. Professor Coombe.
Yeah, thank you. It's actually just doctor, not quite professor, but nevertheless. Thank you for the talk, Professor Babbage. It was very interesting and very pretty slides. It was good visually. Just some clarifications to begin with. So near the beginning of the talk, I might have misunderstood something or misheard, but I think you were saying about homeopathy. And were you arguing in favor of homeopathy as a legitimate science? Or
No. I was pointing out that there is no philosophy of science of homeopathy. There's no philosophy of science of acupuncture. There is no philosophy of science of Ayurveda. None.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. So then my question, just to kick the discussion off, would be if UAPs did turn out to be something beyond our current paradigm, beyond our current understanding, how do you think the scientific method should be modified so that we never again fail to investigate something so important due to the stigma and sometimes ridicule that's attached with the subject?
So thank you for that very basic and very, very, very powerful question, because you've really touched what's key. But exactly that's what the rest of my paper tried to address. He tried to raise the question, which Feyerabend tried to raise in his Against Method, with what happens when you have someone who goes in certain directions. In his case, it was Galileo, and Galileo succeeded for reasons that had nothing to do with his observations. If you read Feyerabend's book, nothing Galileo saw he could have seen. He was lucky, and he stole a great deal from Copernicus while he was at it. But it's not the ordinary understanding of we've got these data and then we study it and then we have hypothesis and then we test it. The standard idea of the scientific method has never been the way science actually proceeds. So Feyerabend is more impressed with Mach and more impressed with Neurath at the time, and he was of course a quantum physicist. And so the question was, how do you get to that? How do you get to the kinds of insights that you could be the Bohr hypothesis and so on and so forth? That's very, very difficult, because right there, that's why I quoted Helen, you're talking about something you can't observe. By definition, you can't observe. You can't observe physics when you're talking the quantum at the quantum level. You've got to try to deal with that kind of the wave function is actually a function of interference at a conceptual level. The collapse of the wave packet and so on. Is that making any sense? Because you've pointed to a very good thing. But what I'm saying is, I don't think that even if we had an actual spacecraft, we would then need to explain it, because it could also just be a one-off. And one of the problems with one-offs is that we don't count those. We don't count those if those are giant skeletons. We don't count them. Anything untoward, all the things in but Fort didn't make up his data. He read newspapers. Everything was attested. Everything was reported one way or another. But those things are just outliers. So you need something that allows you to get a systematized scheme of this and make sense of it in a systematic way that people can then use that will or won't work. There's another field that's called engineering. That makes it work. That's different. It's not quite science. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, thank you for that. Okay, anybody with a hand up wants to ask a question? No hands up.
No hands up.
Yeah.
There's a question from Dr.
Yes, I beg your pardon.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
Silvano.
Yeah, please unmute your microphone, Dr. Silvano, and then ask a question.
Yes. Not sure if I can see me or not, doesn't matter. You made a lot of comments, and I, some of which I do not think I fully understood.
I'm trying.
Two questions are related. At one point, you said that because something is unidentified, it automatically cannot be science, and something like that. And that really puzzled me because, to me, that's the essence of science. And the other question related probably to this is, how do you define something, there is no philosophy of science of X. How do you see that, how do you explain further what it means not to have a philosophy of science of something?
Oh, thank you. Thank you. That's a very, very good question. I'm going to start with the second one, because the second one is rather significant. The second one is one would think easy, you know, chemistry. And chemistry is the kind of science that most people who want to go to medical school fail in college. And they fail it because it's extremely difficult. It's not like physics. So someone who's very good in physics can get failing grades in chemistry, because chemistry does not work with the same, you know, arithmetical logic, you would think. There are compounds, and of course there are ions. It's very, very difficult. And getting into organic and other advanced inorganic complicated chemistry is very difficult indeed. So chemistry is clearly a science. But it's a science that challenges even people interested in studying it to explain it and to make sense of it. It's extremely challenging to figure out exactly what's going on in any chemical relation. Sometimes things are changed in extraordinary ways and you get elemental transformations. There's an actual continuum between alchemy and chemistry. So philosophy of science would like to have a philosophy of chemistry, and they now have one. But I believe it was only established in the last 10 years. So it's very recent that philosophers have managed to get a recognition of something that has been recognized for a very, very long time. And Immanuel Kant uses that as a paradigm example right after Torricelli. He mentions Stahl and a particularly very advanced chemical reaction relationship, putting something in, pulling something out, and getting the same result. So that's the challenge with that. Philosophy of science has to explain all kinds of difficult things in order to explain any of that and to come to an understanding of it, in addition to the fact that we have no idea who Stahl was, because he was an alchemist. So why is Kant talking about him? Very, very challenging point. The other question is to think that philosophy, that science is looking for what we don't know, can't really make any sense. You cannot go out and collect items that you don't know what they are. For example, you cannot go in entomology and collect just random little animal, you know, Kleintier, as the Germans said, little animals. You can't do that. You have to get, otherwise you'll be bringing back insects and all kinds of other, you know, arthropods and things that you don't quite want. You won't be bringing back samples for your lab. You've got to know what you're looking for. That's what a science is. It's a science of X or a science of Y. Does that make...
Well, I would say that there are stages. You know, there are certainly stages where you're simply collecting data that you really don't understand yet. I mean, it took you a long time for scientists to understand what electromagnetism was. They saw things that connected with magnets, and they saw static electricity, sparks. They had no idea. I mean, it took a long time to put that all together and comes up with Maxwell's equations, which was one of the greatest achievements of science, of physics. I don't know whether you call it science or not, I don't know, at this point.
We know what it is, everyone's in agreement. Everyone is in agreement with it. No one disputes it. It's not unidentified.
But it's part of science to go through a phase where you're collecting things you don't understand. And then you start categorizing them, and you start making models. And maybe you will begin to understand. But it's a phase.
Okay, that's not what I said. What I said was something that you still have an explanation and you're working towards what will be a better and a worse explanation. You're not dealing with something unidentified.
I unfortunately have to kind of play the the bad cop here. We're sort of out of time. So if we could perhaps table this very interesting dispute with question, or perhaps we have the closing panel, and then we have a little bit of extra time. But let's thank our speaker, Professor Babat Babish from Fordham University. Thank you very much. Lots of stuff.